Good morning, guys. Good morning, good morning. It's a bright and golden Monday morning right here in Chesapeake, Virginia, within the U.S. of A. Good morning, everyone. Good afternoon, depending on where you're located, where you presently reside. Welcome to the virtual Bible study. And it is right here in Chesapeake, Virginia. We are here. I'm here in the East Coast. Okay, on the East Coast. And I just want to welcome everybody here. Good morning. Just taking our time. Just, you know, just being grateful and thankful for yet another, first of all, another month, another day, another second that God has enabled us to see. I mean, it's truly an honor to be here. We already know that, you know, it wasn't, how should we say it? It wasn't guaranteed that we were going to be here. It wasn't guaranteed that we were going to see this Monday. It wasn't guaranteed that we're going to see this new month, but God saw fit. He saw fit, you know, and the reason being is because there are certain things that he wants us still to work on, still things that he would have us to accomplish. And so I welcome everyone here. So the virtual Bible study, again, this is something we do every single day except Sundays around 8:30 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. Okay, 8:30 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. And so I'm going to actually work on getting this watch party started so that more people can tune in and plug into the virtual Bible study. Good morning, Deborah Williams. Good morning to you. All right, so let me start this thing up here. All right, thank you for your patience, everybody, as I get this thing going. And I know Facebook is probably letting some other individuals know that we're live. Many people are probably waiting for the notification. So, again, welcome to everyone that's gradually joining in. So, let's see here. And then I'm also going to make sure that the audio is
day except
well.
Sundays around 8:30.
So, sounds pretty good. Sounds pretty good here for this watch party. So, let me go ahead and greet everyone. Good morning. All right. And for those of you in the group, good morning to you. Welcome to the virtual Bible study. Once again, good morning. And so what I'm going to do right now is just share with you a little bit about how this got started for those who may be newly plugging in. This is something that started over a year ago where I just felt as though I wanted to invite, you know, some of you on board. And, you know, you're the extended online family, as I would say. One thing, I enjoy social media, but it's even better when you're able to connect with people in person that you've been connected to on social media, right? Being able to meet and connect beyond the social media platform. So grateful for everyone that's in, you know, definitely those who are in the area, the Hampton Roads area, that we were able to connect as well, face to face. But for those of you who are virtual, hopefully one day soon, you know, we'll be able to connect, you know, in person as well. You know, that's even better for me. Especially those of you inside of the group, there are ways in which we can connect as well. There are certain things that I'm plugged into that you might take an interest in. So that will be discovered, you know, when we have one-on-one chat, perhaps in Messenger, we can connect and see how things overlap. So, but I welcome you here to the platform anyhow. All right. So what we're essentially doing with the virtual Bible study is helping you to win on the inside out. Working on, you know, the conditioning of your heart, the conditioning of your mind, you know, helping your heart and your mind to be in alignment, right, with the ways of the kingdom and really being in alignment with God, period. And so, again, we meet here just about every day except Sundays, 8:30 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. We're normally here for around about an hour, almost an hour, because of the newly integrated section that we included, which is talking about understanding kingdom concepts, since that was the primary message that was preached and ministered by Jesus upon his arrival. That's the primary message that has been encouraged for us to continue. Okay? So what do you have to expect? You know, what is it that you can expect here while we're together for this time period? So when we're coming onto the platform, I go over these guidelines, right? And then, you know, we do pray just to make sure that our hearts and minds are ready to receive the word of God. After prayer, we do engage in part number one. Now, part number one involves New Testament reading. So we go through, you know, just reading through the New Testaments. For example, we're actually in Luke. Okay, we're actually going to look at chapter 22, verses 1 through 23. So that's what we're focusing on today. Luke chapter 22, verses 1 through 23. That's the focus. So we'll read it, we'll break it down to understand what inspired Luke to include these verses. We'll talk about how does it apply to our lives. We'll summarize it. And then we're going to transition into talking about, you know, really the keys to abundant kingdom living. Abundant kingdom living. That's really going to be our focus when it comes to the second part of our study. Okay. So remember, there are a couple things that you can do to get those who you are connected to involved. Number one, love the stream. If you know the power that the word of God can have on the lives of others, including yourself. Number two, there is the comment section. You already know what to do with that part, right? And then number three, right? We do have the share feature. So you can share this out. You can be a blessing, start a watch party, bring awareness, you know, to other people about the need to understanding the kingdom of God. Good morning, G.I. Thank you so very much for sharing as well. I do see you here. Good morning, Wendell. Good morning, everybody that's plugged into the study this morning. Good morning. So what we're going to do right now is we're going to dive right into this. We're going to pray, and then we're going to dive into Luke chapter 22. So let's go ahead and pray. So Father in heaven, we thank you so very much for this day. Thank you so much, God, for this moment that you've given each and every one of us, everybody that's here listening in live or even catching the replay. God, we thank you. We thank you for how you've kept us last night. We thank you for how you've given us the ability to get rest for our bodies. We thank you so very much for watching over us, protecting us and our families from dangers seen and unseen. We thank you so much, God, for how you're keeping us and how you're providing for us, how you're meeting every one of our needs. We thank you so much for just you being God. And God alone. There is none like you. There's no one like you. You are God. And beside you, there is no one else. And so, Father, we thank you in this moment. And we just pray and ask that you would forgive us of all sin. That you would cleanse our hearts, our minds, of everything that's not of you. Everything that's not of you, God. Purify us, cleanse us with the precious blood of your dear son, Jesus. Guide us as we're seeking to learn more of you, more about your ways, more about the kingdom ways of how to operate in the kingdom, God. Help us to gain knowledge, understanding, and wisdom as we open up this word, as we read the word and seek to gain, you know, clarity as we read it. And so, Father, may you bless everyone that's connected to us, and may you help us to be a light in this world and salt upon the very earth. So God, we thank you for this opportunity. We just pray that your will be done. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. All right. So welcome aboard, everybody. Luke 22, we're going to start at verse number 1. And it reads as follows. Now, the feast of unleavened bread drew near, which is called Passover. And the chief priests and the scribes sought how they might kill him, for they feared the people. Then Satan entered Judas, surnamed Iscariot, who was numbered among the 12. So he went his way and conferred with the chief priests and captains how he might betray him to them. And they were glad and agreed to give him money. So he promised and sought opportunity to betray him to them in the presence or in the absence of the multitude. Verse 7. Then came the day of unleavened bread when the Passover must be killed. And he sent Peter and John, saying, "Go and prepare the Passover for us, that we may eat." And they said to him, "Where do you want us to prepare?" And he said to them, "Behold, when you have entered the city, a man will meet you carrying a pitcher of water. Follow him into the house which he enters. Then you shall say to the master of the house, the teacher says to you, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? Then he will show you a large, furnished upper room. There make ready. So they went and found it just as he had said to them, and they prepared the Passover. When the hour had come, he sat down and the 12 apostles with him. Then he said to them, with fervent desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I will no longer eat of it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. Then he took the cup and gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you. But behold, the hand of my betrayer is with me on the table. And truly, the Son of Man goes as it has been determined. But woe to that man by whom he is betrayed. Then they began to question among themselves which of them it was who would do this thing. Amen, amen, and amen. So we just finished reading Luke 22, verses 1 through 23. Now, for those of you who are new, we'll definitely be continuing with the chapter on tomorrow morning. By God's grace, we'll be continuing. But let us take a closer look at these verses and study them and gain an even better understanding of what we've read. Okay, so we started at verse number 1, right? Okay, so understanding that this was the Feast of Unleavened Bread, right? Feast of Unleavened Bread, which is called, of course, the Passover. Passover was really a single day, actually followed immediately by the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Now, this whole season would actually be referred to really by either name, either the Passover or Feast of Unleavened Bread, okay? And the priests, they were just trying to figure out how they can just conspire to kill him, to cause him harm, to kill him. And notice what it says in verse number 3, okay? Notice what it says in verse number 3, Satan entered Judas. You see, Judas was possessed by Satan himself. You see that? Satan, he evidently gained direct control over Judas on two occasions. One, just before Judas actually arranged his betrayal with the chief priest. And then again, during the Last Supper. Okay? During the Last Supper, immediately before the betrayal was actually carried out. And then we see in verse number 4, you know, he went his way. He conferred with the chief priests and the captains. In other words, the temple guard is like a security force that consisted of Levites. Okay. Conferred with them how he might betray him. And it says, and they were glad. Right? So they celebrated what they were doing and agreed to give him money to try money in exchange for killing Jesus. So he promised and sought opportunity to betray him to them in the absence of the multitude. Notice again, they didn't want to cause havoc because they knew the people would probably be outraged. And so they were trying to do this in the absence. So not in the presence of the multitude of people. Okay. So it says in verse 7, you know, the day of unleavened bread had came, the Passover had to be killed. And so Jesus actually instructed Peter and John to actually go and prepare the Passover so that they can eat. And so they're trying to figure out where is this going to happen. And so Jesus gives them an idea of where to find the place. And so Peter and John, they went and they found it just as Jesus had said, right? They found it just as Jesus had said, and they prepared the Passover. Okay, they prepared it. And so when the time had come, they sat down. He sat down with the 12 apostles, okay? And, you know, he said, he's just letting them know, like, this is the last time that we're really going to eat before, it's fulfilled in the kingdom of God. Okay, so until the kingdom of God comes, this will be the last time that he would sup with them. And so he began to share with them a little bit about what we know today as the Lord's Supper. Okay, because he took the bread, he gave thanks, he broke it, and he actually gave it to them, letting them know at this particular point in verse 19, this is my body, right? This is my body. So it represented the body of Christ, or his body, okay? It represented his body, symbolic of his actual body. Yet unbroken, but was, you know, there with them, but this is just in observance, in remembrance, do this in remembrance of him, okay? Now, when it says in remembrance of him, you know, Passover had, you know, looked forward to the sacrifice of Christ. That's something we have to note. Passover had looked forward to the sacrifice of Christ. He transformed the cedar into an altogether really different ceremony, which looks back in remembrance at his atoning death. Okay? So it's looking back at it. And notice what happens as well in verse number 20. He says he also took the cup after his supper, saying, this cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you. Okay? This is the third, you know, third of the four cups in the Passover celebration. Okay? So understand something here. Again, this representing the new covenant. That's why it says this cup is the new covenant. The cup only represented the new covenant, okay? It only represented the new covenant. And then we see in verse 21, it says, behold, the hand of my betrayer is with me on the table. I mean, think about it. To be at the same table with the person whom you know is going to betray you. You know it. Okay? You know it. See, you have to fully submit to the will of God to know that your betrayer is sitting at the same table with you and you're going forward and moving forward. Right? But notice, of course, the disciple, the apostles, they begin to question amongst themselves, who would actually do something like this? Who would actually betray Jesus? Okay, who would actually do this? You see, every detail of the crucifixion of Christ was under the sovereign control of God. Every detail. And it was in accordance with his eternal purpose. There was a reason why these things were done. Okay? The fact that Judas's betrayal was a part of God's plan does not free him from the guilt, though. It's not going to free, it didn't free Judas of the guilt, okay, of this crime that he entered into willfully. He did it upon his own will. You see, God's sovereignty is never a legitimate excuse for human guilt at all. Okay, at all. But he went forward and did it. And so understand this, okay? Everything that we experience in life, everything, you know, it's allowed to happen, but it also serves a sovereign purpose as well. Sometimes we don't understand the things that happen, whether it be, sometimes we think we understand the positive things that happens in our lives. And then we, you know, when we think about all the hardship that we face, we're wondering why certain things happen. But a lot of these things are allowed to happen because it serves a bigger purpose that sometimes we may not completely understand. But here's the beauty of it. You know, being citizens of the kingdom, you know, always know that God has a greater good in mind. He's going to make sure that we're taken care of, right? He's going to make sure that all is well. So it shouldn't be anything that we have to worry about, okay? Despite how it may look with our natural eye, we have to trust God. Even when the situation seems terrible, like, and you begin to question, like, why is this happening? Or why did this happen? It serves a sovereign purpose. And although a lot of people, for example, a lot of people probably asked, you know, why, for example, did that happen to Kobe Bryant and his his daughter, and all those who are a part of that tragic accident. Everything, no matter, even if we don't understand it or not, everything serves a sovereign purpose. Everything. Whether we understand it or not, it serves a sovereign purpose. And, and some of it, it may appear, as obvious, and then some may not. And I know even for example, his wife, Vanessa Bryant, I know she may not understand the full picture of it, but the most important thing, gradually understanding that God is in control. Okay, and he knows what's best and that he'll take care of her and everyone that was impacted by that incident. Okay, and that just goes to show with anything that happens in our lives, that was just an example, but with anything that happens in our lives, God ultimately is in control and he's aware of everything. Okay, aware of everything. So what I want to do right now is I want to shift. I want to begin to talk about, how can we live a life of abundance? How do we live a life of success and abundance as kingdom citizens? A lot of times, we talk about, this life as far as being a believer and, but we don't truly understand how to live a life of abundance. And some people question, they're like, man, why is it that people who love God continue to struggle? Okay, why does struggle still exist as far as living a life that I'm not saying that everybody's going to be rich. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that everybody's going to have an extreme abundant amount of money. I'm not saying all of that either. But why is it that some people struggle? Like there's this extreme hardship. Well, let's talk about it a little bit. You see, because most people live today actually out of alignment with the government of God's kingdom. Okay, most people live out of alignment. And unfortunately, this is actually true amongst those who really are kingdom citizens. See, because of instead of pursuing God's priorities of the kingdom and righteousness, we actually are pursuing things. Can we just be honest? No matter how hard we try or how great our desire, the qualities we truly want most in life always really seem to be out of our grasp, right? And our lives are really out of alignment because we're focused on possessions rather than on position. That's something that ought to be written down. Okay? We focus our time, in most cases, on possessions than we do position. That's the huge problem right there. That's one of the main reasons why people struggle. As believers, you pursue possessions rather than position. Okay, see, many of us today, we're disconnected because, between the promises of the kingdom and and our personal reality of daily experience. You see, many of us live beyond our means. We spend more money than we make. Can we just be honest? And no, I might be stepping on some toes, but sometimes we have to hear the truth. We buy cars too expensive for our budgets, houses that we can't make payments on, right? Designer clothes we can't afford. All in the interest of trying to keep up or show up, show up our neighbors. Some people say keep up with the Joneses, right? We're in so much debt and then always seem to end up with too much month left at the end of your money, right? You got a whole lot of month left at the end of your money. So what's the problem? What's the problem? See, we're obsessed with things. We are obsessed with things. Understand, food is a thing. Water is a thing. A house is a thing. A car is a thing. Money is a thing. You see, all of these are just things. And our pursuit of things is destroying us. Okay, our obsession with things is a hunger we will never satisfy. We will never satisfy that. It will gnaw at us so that the more we get, the more hungry we become. And as long as we pursue the things, guess what? We will never know true peace and contentment, right? Contentment. See, deliverance is only found in one place. Here's how you get delivered from that. And you have to be in pursuit of the kingdom and righteousness of God. Again, be in pursuit of the kingdom and righteousness of God. This is a matter of exchanging one hunger for another. Exchange one hunger for another. Our hunger for things will never be satisfied. You see, Jesus said, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled." So how are we going to be filled? When we pursue the right things. When we hunger and thirst for righteousness. So how hungry are you? That's my question for those of you who are listening. How hungry are you? Right? What are you hungry for? Is your hunger for the kingdom greater than your hunger for things? How hungry are you? Do you thirst for righteousness more than you thirst for material prosperity? And this is my question for all my fellow wealth builders out there too. Do you thirst for righteousness more than you thirst for material prosperity? Listen to what David said, okay, in Psalms. And this is something I quote often. "Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart." Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. So if the kingdom and righteousness of God are your primary desires and your delights, he will take care of everything else. Everything else. He said it. He says, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness." So he's using infinitives, you know, which means continuing action, right? Continuing. So if you say, "I'm hungry" or "I'm thirsty," you're referring to a temporary condition, right? However, if you say, "I hunger" or "I thirst," you're speaking of continuous desires, something continuous. So you continue to be hungry. You continue to be thirsty. Right? So imagine struggling in a desert, right? Under a blanket, or I should say under sun, without food and water. So you're stranded on a desert, you know, you don't have any food, you don't have any water. After a couple of days, and maybe even less than that, the only thing on your mind, right, would be the desire of satisfying your hunger and your thirst. Nothing else is going to matter, will it? And so you're willing to sacrifice anything, give up anything, part with anything, do anything to fill that craving in your heart. So Jesus said it this way. You know, he said this, you know, this is the kind of all-consuming desire you should have for the kingdom and righteousness of God. Okay, think about it. Even the psalmist said it, the Hebrew psalmist. He says, "As the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living water. When can I go and meet with God?" When can I go and meet with him? That's actually Psalm 42. So this continuing hunger and thirst for righteousness really positions us to enter into the fullness of kingdom life. Now, remember that righteousness is a legal term. We already confirmed that, right? Righteousness is a legal term. It actually means to really be in alignment with authority, okay? To be in right standing with the governing power. See, the key to maintaining that right standing. So you come into right standing when you accept Christ, right? You believe in what he's done for you as far as paying the price for you and dying for you, right? We understand that part. But the key to maintaining that right standing is obedience to the laws of that government. See, in a kingdom, since the king's word is law, we talked about that as well, righteousness means fulfilling the king's requirements. Again, righteousness means fulfilling the king's requirements. See, our pursuit of righteousness places us in right positioning, okay? Our pursuit of righteousness places us as citizens, kingdom citizens, in the right positioning to receive all the rights, all the resources, or the blessings, all the privileges of the kingdom that is really ours as kingdom citizens. It puts us in the right position to receive it. So in this positioning, there is a part that we play and a part that God plays at the same time. So he has a part, we have a part. You see, our part is to obey the laws of the government, right? We already confirmed that. Keeping ourselves in alignment. We have to obey the laws. You see, God's part is really to open up to us the resources of heaven. It is a very simple dynamic here. We obey, God opens. We disobey, he closes. That's just that simple, right? Again, we obey, God opens. We disobey, he closes. That's it. See, as long as we obey the law, we have access. As soon as we disobey or we get out of alignment, you know, that access shuts down. This explains why so many of us, or so many believers, I'm going to say believers in general, okay, struggle from day to day. They struggle. You wonder, like, why are they struggling if they're believers? Many believers struggle from day to day, pinching pennies, right? Trying to make ends meet, but never seem to have enough, right? They don't have any peace, no joy, no contentment. Why is that? Why is that the case? They are out of alignment with their government. They are out of alignment, and their access to the kingdom and kingdom resources has been shut off. It's been shut off. Some people, you know, I know this may be new, and some people may not truly understand it. Some of you may not even agree, and it's okay. It's in your word, right? It's in the Bible. So you might just be saying that you just don't agree with the Bible. Okay. Right? But the word is the word. The word is the word. So whenever this happens, it's important. It's really always due to sin. Okay. So whenever someone is cut off from kingdom resources, it's always due to sin. And sin simply is breaking the law. Okay. That's really what sin is. Sin is breaking the law, you know, and the Greek word for sin, it really means to miss the mark, especially in the New Testament. To miss the mark. Miss the mark. It's like an archery term, you know, falling short of the target, sort of like that. You see, sin interrupts our communication with God and shuts down that flow of his resources to us. You know, think about it in terms of even in Psalm 66, okay? Psalm 66, it says, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear. Okay. Again, if I regard or if I have iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear. That's Psalm 66 and 18. See, iniquity, and I know you're probably saying, well, what is iniquity then? Iniquity is another word for sin. Okay. It's another word for sin. But it refers specifically to invisible sin. Invisible sin, like greed, envy, lust, hatred. And even worse, you know, it's actually worse than physical sin. You see, invisible sin is secret sin. It actually gives rise to that visible sin in action. So it starts in your heart. You sin first in your heart. Okay? Righteous, and so then it goes back to saying this, righteous positioning really means keeping our hearts pure. That's where it starts then. If it doesn't manifest and it doesn't happen physically first, it starts invisibly in our hearts, then therefore righteous positioning means keeping our hearts pure. Okay? Keeping our hearts pure, clean. Right? Clean, uncorrupted by iniquity. See, if we harbor no sin, no secret sins in our heart, there'll be nothing to give rise to even visible sin. So you ever wonder why you see people do certain things? They didn't just go and do it. It started within. It started within their hearts. They were harboring it within their hearts. See, purity of heart is critical. It's critical to the key to abundant kingdom life. And Jesus said it specifically. He said, blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. again, blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. So this means that the pure in heart will see God in everything. Okay. And the word heart here really means mind. It really means your mind. So if our minds are pure, we will see God in everything and in everyone. And this is the answer to the problem of greed or even lust or jealousy. Okay. Improper thought, attitude. Okay. So what a challenge to live at such a level in this world today. I say that because a lot of people struggle with it. But that is just the challenge that the king really calls his citizens to take up, a challenge that we can actually be successful in. Okay. Very successful in. So let me just put it this way. There are a couple other points that I really do want to make. Okay. Really important for us to note. See, here's a point. David, I know y'all remember David, right? The psalmist. Okay. David actually contrasts the righteous with the wicked. And I'm saying this, I'm gonna get to a point. I'm about to make a point. He says it in Psalms 37. He says, the wicked borrow and do not repay. Okay. The wicked borrow and they do not repay, but the righteous give generously. Those the Lord blesses will inherit the land, but those he curses will be cut off. So righteousness is aligning ourselves with God's character and his nature. So in this way, we grow to become like him, and he's a giver. So because God is a giver, when we get into right positioning with him, we will, you know, he will give us more than we know what to do with. And because we're becoming like him, we cannot help but become generous givers as well. So the prosperity of the righteous is an ongoing blessing from God that really expands generations. Okay. It's giving. It's all about giving too. Okay. Giving. That's a trait. That's a trait of a kingdom citizen. See, right positioning places us under the protection of the king, who would actually preserve us even when the wicked are destroyed. Okay, he will preserve us. And ultimately, the real estate of the kingdom is reserved for the righteous, for those who are lined up with the kingdom government. I know we hear about this. Y'all already know what I'm about to say. We spoke about this the other day, where we talked about that scripture all the time. The wealth of the wicked is laid up for the just. Who are the just? Kingdom citizens. Who are kingdom citizens? Those who are in alignment, right alignment with the king. Those who have a relationship with the king, with the God of the Bible, right? We're talking about kingdom citizens, the God of the Bible. Okay. The destiny, the prosperity, for example, of even the Israelites back in the day was really connected to the land. And even today, the only true material wealth of any lasting value, okay, and we said this before, is real estate. Real estate, lasting value, okay? So if you want to leave your children and your grandchildren a valuable legacy, leave them land and everything that's in the land. I got to add that little piece too. Leave them also the legacy of your example of not necessarily laying up treasures on earth, which actually pass away, but treasures in heaven, which actually last forever. Okay. That's what you want to leave them. So understand something. Not only will the righteous, not only will those who are kingdom citizens inherit land to dwell in forever, but that land will be covered by a peace and security that the world knows nothing about. They don't know anything about it. Okay. And think about this. You know, it says it in the word, in Isaiah 32, it says, the fruit of righteousness will be peace. The effect of righteousness will be quietness and confidence forever. It says, my people will live in peaceful dwelling places, in secure homes, in undisturbed places of rest. Wow. Whew, what a promise. See, first, if we are righteous, we will enjoy the fruit of peace Why is that? Because we're not living for the pursuit of things anymore. You see, our hunger for things actually robs us of peace. Your pursuit and your hunger for things will rob you of peace. You know, peace is that sense, in this sense, means the absence of frustration and worry. Okay. Does this describe your life? Are you at peace? Think about that for yourself. And then secondly, based on that scripture, peace will produce the effect of quietness, or some people say like a calm disposition, even in trouble. See, nothing will disturb us. So the question we have to ask ourselves is, do you have a calm, quiet disposition no matter what happens? No matter what happens. Even today, what's going on in this world today, do you have a calm, quiet disposition no matter what happens? And then that the third promise that comes along with that scripture there, peace produces confidence. In other words, trust and faith in the care, the provision that God, you know, in God's government or part of God's government. So this means that we can go to sleep at night free of worry, free of fear and uncertainty, because we know that our King has us covered. Okay, our King has us covered. So let's go back. What did the scripture say? Peaceful dwelling places, secure homes, undisturbed places of rest. Who wouldn't give anything they had for that kind of peace and security? See, this is the guaranteed inheritance of the righteous. Now, I have to put this point out here. Unlike religion, which focuses in on externals, right? You guys see it. They focus on externals, what you see on the outside. I have to say it. You already know. They focus on the outside so much. Life, this is different. Life in the kingdom of God focuses on inner transformation that manifests in external ways. We focus on, as believers, kingdom citizens, we focus on inner change that actually manifests in external ways. Okay? That's why Paul said, he said, for the kingdom of God is not a manner of eating or drinking. It's not about eating or drinking. It's not about those things that you can see, but it's a matter of righteousness, of peace, of joy in the Holy Spirit. Because anyone who serves Christ in this way is pleasing to God and approved by man. It says that in Romans 14. That's another amazing promise, right? One of the fruits of right positioning is that we please God, number one, and then we receive the approval of other people, right? We receive the approval of other people. Not that we're, you know, really seeking, you know, approval from other people, but it just happens. It's one of those things that happens. Okay. So pleasing God should be our focus. It really should be. Pleasing God should be our focus rather than pleasing people. Because when we're pleasing to God, he causes the approval of people to fall upon us. Like they don't have any choice. Now, I'm not saying that in a prideful way, but it just happens. It happens. People approving of us does not necessarily mean that they will like us. They might do stuff and, you know, just say, okay, and not even truly understand why they're saying it. Right? So it doesn't mean that they're going to like us. It may be simply that they see a righteous and honorable quality in our lives that they cannot help but respect. Right? See, our righteousness brings pleasure to God. Okay? And it really elicits the respect and approval of people. So righteousness then is the primary key to kingdom living. That is what we're really trying to say here. Righteousness is the primary key to kingdom living. And here's the thing though, now that we know this, we have to understand too that knowledge is the key to everything in life. Okay, knowledge is the key to everything in life, and it is no different with righteousness. The key to righteousness is knowledge of the law. Okay? Again, the key to righteousness is knowledge of the law. But how can we obey the law if we don't know it? Right? Isn't that true? How can we obey the law if we don't know it? This is why it's important for us to study the laws of the government under which, you know, under whose authority we live. So as kingdom citizens, we live under the king's government, and his word is law. His word is law. So since the Bible is the written code of law for the kingdom of God, it's important. It's like we have to, as kingdom citizens, we have to read it. We have to study it. We have to know it. We need to know the laws of our kingdom so we can stay in sync with them and in right positioning with the king. And see, knowledge of the Bible will also help us to know, you know, the king himself. How can you claim to be a believer, but you don't know the king? And see, in reading the word of God, it will give you a greater understanding of his heart, his mind, his will, his ways, his thoughts, you know, all of these things. You know, a knowledge of the Bible, which is our kingdom constitution, right? It's really the key to effective citizenship in the kingdom. Some of you, you know, I'm glad that some of you are tuning in. You might want to actually go back and listen to some of our previous sessions where we're talking about, you know, kingdom citizenship at the very beginning. Okay. So it's important to understand that ignorance of your constitution or a person's constitution is dangerous in two ways, right? First, ignorance of the law can actually lead to inadvertent violation of the law, which actually results in legal penalties and loss of alignment with the government, okay? And then secondly, ignorance of the law actually means also ignorance of your rights under the law. So if we don't know what our citizen rights are, how can we claim them? How can we claim them if we don't know what they are? So ignorance of the law means that we lose twice, right? You pay a violation if you violate the law, and then you don't know what your rights are under the law, right? So the same thing is true in the kingdom of God. If we don't know our constitution, the word of God, we will not be able to obey it or claim any rights as kingdom citizens. And the Bible itself states that it exists for the specific purpose of training us for kingdom living, right? It says it, 2 Timothy 3:16 says it. All scripture is God breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. It specifically says it right there. Right? God gave us his word so we can learn how to live in his kingdom. Right? Righteous living does not come naturally, even for us as kingdom citizens. It doesn't come naturally. We have to train our minds so we can walk in the things of God and discipline our bodies to do the same thing, to do the right thing. See, if we know what to do every day, we will know also how to do it right. The Bible is the constitution of the kingdom of God and the source of righteousness for us as citizens. Let's take it one step further, and then we're going to begin to wrap it up for today. Knowledge of the Constitution and principles of the kingdom is important for us as kingdom citizens, but just as vital is our needs to stand boldly and firmly for them before the world. You see, the people of the world are looking. They're looking for the kingdom. But how will they learn of it if we keep silent? Think about it. They're looking for the kingdom. But how would they learn if we're silent? See, David understood this. This is why he said, I desire to do your will, O my God. Your law is within my heart. I proclaim righteousness in the great assembly. I do not seal my lips. As you know, O Lord, I do not hide your righteousness in my heart. I speak of your faithfulness and salvation. I do not conceal your love and your truth from the great assembly. He said that. Psalm 40. Okay. His was the world of politics and warfare and government, you know. That's what his was, David. So many people insist that we should never mix faith and politics, right? Such a concept would have been completely foreign to David. In that instance, he was a man after God's own heart. He never shrank back from telling anyone within earshot of the mercies, the glory, the love, right, of the Lord. So how we need today, believing politicians and CEOs and managers and supervisors, employees who will stand up for righteousness and say, here is where I stand. Now we need people who will say, I will not cheat. I will not lie. I will not cut corners. I will not accept bribes. I will not take kickbacks. I will not steal time from my employer, because all these things violate my higher law, right? The law of heaven. We need people who will say, I will pursue honor, honesty, excellence in everything we do, because I keep, you know, these keep me in right positioning with my King. Okay? If you get fired for your stand, so what? God has you covered. He honors, he protects, he rewards the righteous. Jesus says this, blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. I have to tell you, I mean, many a times when I was in the corporate space and I was doing what was right and they wanted me to do what was wrong, I got fired, right? But the next moment of opportunity, doors began to open that people truly didn't understand because of the stance that I took, standing for what is right instead of conforming to what people want you to do, knowing that it wasn't right to do. So positioning places us under proper authority in the kingdom. It really, really does. And so we're going to speak more about this. I have so much more to say, but I know the hour is getting a little bit late. We've been here for almost an hour. And so I want to make sure that you all truly understand what it is that we've gone over thus far. Okay. Knowing the importance of our Constitution, understand our Constitution is the Word of God. It's the Bible. Okay. And we have to understand it in order to truly live by it. You can't live by something that you don't know. Right? And if you don't know what's in the Word of God, if you don't know what His will is, how would you be able to keep it? How would you be able to align yourself with it if you don't know it? Now, are we going to know it perfectly, you know, word for word? We'll know the concepts. We'll know what it is that He would have us to do. We may not know it word for word, but it'll be in our hearts. And by the leading of the Holy Spirit, He will help you, you know, to keep it, to obey it. And that's the most important piece. I had to tell people that. I said, you know, even for myself, you know, I'm like, this is a lot for us to keep. But as you align yourself, when you're aligned with God and you have His Spirit within you, He guides you. He helps you to be able to maintain, to keep these things. And we already know, as long as you're seeking the kingdom first and His righteousness, you'll be able to fulfill everything. As long as you keep those two commandments, loving God with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and loving your neighbor as you do yourself, the word says, the whole word hangs upon those two commandments. Those two commandments right there. If you keep those two, because think about it, all those other things, you know, sins and different things like that, hangs upon those. Like if you obey those two things, loving God, loving your neighbor, how are you going to do things that will, why would you do something that will jeopardize your love for God or jeopardize your desire to want to love your neighbor? That includes people on social media too. Okay. So you wouldn't cause things, you know, do things or say things that will cause harm, you know, or try to, you know, purposely hurt other individuals because you're trying to, number one, you love God. And number two, you love your neighbor. Okay. So I'm grateful to have every one of you guys here. Please note that the virtual Bible study, we try to do this every single morning, except Sundays. Okay. Around 8:30 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. And so normally we start with a New Testament reading. So we're in the Gospel of Luke. Okay, we're going to be soon wrapping that up, but we're in the Gospel of Luke, and then we transition into talking about kingdom living a bit more in depth during the latter part of the study. Okay, so be with us tomorrow morning. Join us here on the platform. For those of you inside of the group, I normally try to do a watch party, but if you don't see the watch party pop up, you might want to send me a friend request. That way you can remain connected that way, and you can be informed as to when we go live again. All right, everybody, let's prepare to pray so that we can be dismissed. All right, let us pray. So, Father in heaven, Lord, we say thank you so very much for this time that you've given us. We thank you so much for how you've kept us. We thank you for this word, which truly is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. We thank you so much, God, for how you're sharing and opening up to us how we ought to live, how we ought to pursue this life of being in right standing with you, maintaining right standing with you, being able to live a life of abundance as kingdom citizens. And so, Father, we just pray and ask that you would continue to guide us and direct us by your Spirit. Help us, Father God, that in all that we do, that we seek to please you. And so, Father, we're praying even for our family members, for our friends, our loved ones, that they too would hunger and thirst after righteousness and that they would be filled. And so, God, we thank you so much for everything you've done. We thank you for even the new doors of opportunity that you will provide. We thank you so much, God, for everything, for your provisions on a daily basis, God, meeting every one of our needs, giving us the desires of our hearts. We thank you for that. And we just pray that in all that we do, that we will live this life to please you, that we will pursue position over things, possessions. Help us to put our position, to seek our position, seeking righteousness first over possessions, because you're the owner of the possessions. And so, God, we thank you, we love you, and we ask all of these things and many blessings in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. All right, everyone. Thank you so much for being here with me this morning for the virtual Bible study. We'll be back tomorrow morning around 8:30 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. And just as I always share, I love you guys. And God loves you all the more. Be blessed.